You heard just now from Comrade Vaigai about Kashmir. I'll come to that issue, but not repeat what she said. But this is part of a larger, multi-pronged offensive unleashed by the Modi government after assuming office of the government after the 2019 general elections. Every single aspect of our constitution, of our rule, constitutional rule of law, and our republic, all the foundations are being assaulted by the current government, which is unfolding in a very rapid manner in these last few months. Kashmir is, of course, a very most brazen thing, but what is happening in the northeast, what is happening with the National Register of Citizens, and the other developments that are happening in terms of assaults on our constitutional institutions, beginning from the parliament itself, the judiciary, all other independent institutions of our constitution, and the individual human rights and civil liberties of individuals in our country. This constitutes the most serious assault and offensive against India's constitutional order, which seeks to undermine our secular democratic republic. And on top of it all is this economic mess this government is now creating in our country, where the misery of the people is growing in a multi-dimensional manner, and there is no solution that appears to our economic crisis today, which according to me would be a recession. It's not merely a slowdown, but it's an economic recession that has begun. And instead of tackling these serious problems, which are creation of his own government, our Prime Minister is in the United States of America campaigning for Donald Trump. And he's going there to say, in the name of Howdy Modi, he's given the slogan that he gave for himself, that Ab Ki Baar Trump Sarkar, that he's gone there to tell the people, and particularly the NRI Indians, who are not Indians anymore because they are citizens of the USA, that they should all vote for Mr. Donald Trump. He said that, and the next day, the US Congress has initiated proceedings of impeachment against Donald Trump. So you know the sort of people that Mr. Modi backs, the sort of people like Mr. Modi who destroy democratic rights, who spread racism, hatred, who spread violence and hatred in order to consolidate their political rule. That is the closeness between Donald Trump and Narendra Modi. And in India, we have a law. No foreigner can come here to campaign in our domestic elections. Recently, a very, very popular Bengali lead actor from Bangladesh was called to campaign by the ruling party in Bengal, and promptly Mr. Modi's government sent him back saying that you cannot do that. But Mr. Modi himself goes to campaign in a foreign country. This is the morality of these people. India is burning, people's lives are burning, but they are today trying to do their image building in the world. And this is something that is costing India dearly. And this is something which today, as the people, we must say, not acceptable. You address the problems facing the people and resolve these problems in the interests of Indian people and the Indian country, and not in the interests of the world leaders. That's why you see what has happened in Kashmir. The legal implications of what was done has been explained. But what is the political campaign? They said by doing what they have done in Kashmir, India has today been completely independent, become independent. There is no state in the country that has any special provision. Everybody in India is equal. This is a complete untruth. Article 370 is not the only article in the Indian Constitution providing special provisions to any state. The Indian Constitution has, I don't know if Vaigai has explained, but Indian Constitution has Article 371 that has, apart from 371, from 371A to I, various articles which have given special status to 12 or more states in India, including mainly the northeastern states, but this includes Maharashtra, Gujarat, Andhra Pradesh, now Telangana, Goa. All these states are covered by some special provision or the other. To say that only J&K has special provisions and therefore we have integrated India and liberated India to its true freedom is absolutely absolute untruth. The other thing they argue is now outsiders can go and buy land in Jammu and Kashmir. You can now marry Kashmiri girls. First of all, let the Kashmiri girl agree to marry you. Now, unless of course you want to use the normal BJP tactic of resorting to unlawful ways of trying to violate and commit crimes on women. This is not something automatic that is going to happen. Then you said buying land. Today you cannot buy land in Uttarakhand and Himachal Pradesh where BJP state governments are there. Today you cannot buy land in most of these northeastern states. Today you cannot buy land in any of the scheduled areas which are declared as tribal lands. No outsider can go and buy land there. So what is the special thing saying that now anybody can go and buy land in J&K and therefore India is equal, equal rights to operate everywhere? All this is sheer political propaganda. And this is based again on a blatant untruth. And it's only for their political propaganda that this is being done. Mr. Modi goes to USA and he says now that we have removed Article 370, which is also wrong. Article 370 is still there in the Constitution. It's not been removed. It's only been made inoperable for J&K today. But the way in which they reduced one a state in the Indian Union into two union territories, the illegality of that entire thing through a subterfuge that they employed, which I'm sure Comrade Vaige would have explained, that is a very serious assault on our democratic secular federal principles of our constitution. Tomorrow any state, any non-BJP ruled state can be brought under central rule. The governor would be given the authority, the state assembly dissolved, and that state, the statehood can be removed and they be dissolved into different union territories or any part like Nilgiris in the Tamil Nadu. If they say it's got a big tourist potential, you declare that as a union territory. Let the revenue go to the central government, not to the government of Tamil Nadu. This sort of a thing can be done by undermining Article 3 of our constitution, saying that any boundaries of a state will have to get the sanction of the elected state government. Now they have replaced the elected state government with the governor, who is not elected, who is his executive appointee, and taking the governor's sanction, you dissolve a state and remove the statehood. This has very serious, grave consequences for India's future. This can happen with any state in our country, at any time, at their whim, and this is something that entirely undermines the foundations of our constitutional order today. Now the other charge, other claim they make is that because of this move of what they did in Jammu and Kashmir, terrorism will end. The first 5 years of Mr. Modi, the terrorism, every aspect of terrorist attacks on India have grown multiple times. There is official data. Today the Home Ministry is not giving this official data because the truth will come out. And as far as fight against terrorism, they claim they are fighting terrorism. Why have you detained Mahmoud Yusuf Tarigami without any charge, without any invoking any act, without invoking any section of any law? You have kept him under house arrest. When we managed to bring him to Delhi, get him treated, meet the media, and then he said that with other political leaders detained in Kashmir, my staying out in Delhi and moving around freely, that will not be correct. My solidarity with the people of Kashmir, so I think we should go back. And we sent him back, correct point that he made. He sent back, the moment he landed in Srinagar, is back into house arrest. What is the charge? No charge. Is he arrested? No, he is not arrested. Is he kept under detention? No, he is not kept under detention. What is this? You are by force keeping people in their homes, saying you cannot get out, nobody can come to see you. And you say all this is required to fight terrorism. Mohammed Yusuf Tarigami was attacked thrice in order to take his life by the terrorists. For 24 years he represents a constituency in the worst terror-stricken area in the whole of Kashmir, that is the Anantnag district. his constituency, that is called Kulgam, in spite of the terror attacks, two of his family members were killed by terrorists in these attacks. He narrowly escaped three times. In spite of that, the people of that area continuously support him because of his fight against terrorism. If there is a fight against terrorism that is there in Kashmir, it is not Mr. Modi or this BJP, but it is this red flag that is waging that fight, and that is this red flag that will keep our unity together. And now they claim that they are fighting terrorism. I'm asking the BJP to name one freedom fighter of theirs who lost their life and sacrificed for the country. I'm asking the BJP to name one person who fought the terrorism in Punjab when the Khalistani movement was there. Show us one by BJP martyr of yours. Show us one person in the whole of Jammu and Kashmir who died because of terrorist attacks that who belongs to the BJP. None. And today you go to the Andaman and Nicobar Islands, you go to the cellular jail, the list of the prisoners that is now there on marble, 70 or 75% of them had a communist orientation, and those who survived came back and joined the active communist movement till they died. Only person that the RSS BJP claims is that of Savarkar, who was there in the cellular jail, but he left the cellular jail after submitting his apologies and surrendering to the British and saying, leave me from here, I will not take part in it. This is all on record. And now they claim that they are fighters against terrorism. Why have they isolated Kashmir, Jammu and Kashmir, and not done this to the other states in India? Because Jammu and Kashmir is the only state in India which has a Muslim majority. Targeting of Jammu and Kashmir is to sharpen this Hindu-Muslim polarization. And that is their agenda. Sharpen Hindu-Muslim polarization, to raise the bogey of terrorism that they are fighting it, and therefore raise the issue of cross-border terrorism in Pakistan, which all of us have opposed, we continue to oppose. There is no speciality in them opposing alone. The whole nation opposes and fights. But Muslim Pakistan versus Hindu India, Muslim Jammu and Kashmir versus Hindu rest of India. That is the polarization. They want to consolidate the Hindutva communal vote bank at the expense of the Indian nation, at the expense of unity of our country, and the expense of the unity of our people and solidarity of our people with this immense diversity. They want to impose a uniformity. That is what they want to do. That requires the destruction of this constitution. It's only then the RSS concept of replacing secular democratic India by their Hindutva Rashtra, a rabidly intolerant fascistic rule, that can succeed. That requires the destruction of our present secular democratic constitutional order, and that is the larger aim of all these developments that is taking place. That is why when I went there, I was the only person from outside of Jammu and Kashmir to enter Jammu and Kashmir for a long time. Now my colleague Ghulam Nabi Azad has now managed to enter. So when I went there, people were asking, he said, sir, is India going to treat us, Kashmir, as Israel treats the Palestinians? Are we under your military occupation? Is the Kashmir Valley going to be the Gaza Strip of Palestine? A place where the continuous protest actions that take place, continuous atrocities by the Israeli and his armies? Is India following the Israel model of the persecution of Palestinians and denying them their own homeland? Is that the model for Narendra Modi in India? Honestly, I was speechless. I couldn't reply. Because, frighteningly, that is the direction in which this government is taking the situation. If that were to happen, then it is not a question of peace and stability in the region. It is a question of destruction of peace and stability in the region, and it's a question of destroying our constitutional order and the Indian Republic as we know of it is today. That is, the question of Jammu and Kashmir is not an issue confined to Jammu and Kashmir alone or its people. It is a question confined to every Indian who has to raise his voice, saying today the battle is between Hindutva nationalism that the BJP and the RSS rise, and between Indian patriotism which runs through all of us as the basis of the foundation of our country. And this is the battle that has to be joined. Unless this is joined, we can't save India today. Forget changing it for the better tomorrow. And this has to be joined, because you have to join to destroy the other larger, bigger agendas that are being pursued simultaneously. So therefore, this entire effort of trying to convert India into their version of a Hindutva Rashtra requires the unitary state structure. Unitary state structure means uniformity. What India must celebrate is strengthening the bonds of commonality in our diversity. Instead of that, they want to impose uniformity. One nation, one culture. One nation, one language. One nation, one party. Now our Home Minister says, why multi-party system? One nation, one party. And a little later it will be, why a party? One nation, one leader. And after that, whether, I don't know whether they'll reach the stage of saying, why a woman, one nation, one man? You know, their absurdity goes on to the extent of trying to create uniformity of everything, so that it becomes easier to achieve their target. And it is through that process that various other attacks are going on today. Now, what is today happening in the Northeast? The National Register of Citizens was part of the Assam Accord when that whole disturbance was taking place there against foreigners. Agreement was reached and the National Register of Citizens was to be prepared. That has now been prepared. It has left out 20 lakh people, nearly 20 lakh people outside of the list. People who have been born here, whose families have been living here for generations, not only Muslims but also a large number of Hindus, they are all being excluded. Now it's a big process for them through their legal process in order to re-establish that they are Indian citizens. How many will succeed or not, that nobody knows. But in the process they have built detention camps where these people are being sent and to live in most inhuman conditions. We have demanded, close the detention camps, let them live like they are living till their entire case is adjudicated. But in the process, now they are saying that they will extend this to all over the country, all over the country. There will be NRC in every state in India. Who are the foreigners who have come? Now, people in the south think that we, at least we are saved, so we are there. But you in Tamil Nadu and people in the south are not. Because infiltration of foreigners is not only Bangladesh or from Pakistan or from Afghanistan. It's also from Sri Lanka. It's also from other places. So nobody is spared. And now they are starting what is called the National Population Register, where the cutoff would be who is an Indian citizen in the, from the cutoff year is 1951. Yesterday I was in Puducherry. Puducherry joined the Indian Union in 1954. And it became a legal entity in India in 1963. So 1951, cutoff date, National Population Register. Are they Indians? Goa joined, liberated in 1961, 62. By the time they joined India, it was 66, 67, legally. Are they Indians under the NPR? What are they trying to do? And along with this, when you point out that more than half the people left out of the NRC in Assam are Hindus, then what does our Home Minister say? Non-Muslims and non-Christians, you don't worry. We are going to amend the Citizenship Amendment Bill, whereby we'll grant citizenship to all those people who came to India, who are Hindus, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jains, etc., etc., but Muslims or Christians. So they are appeasing them, saying that we will give you citizenship. But this citizenship amendment bill, determining citizenship on the basis of religion of a person, is completely violative of our constitution today. Where the constitution transfers and gives the right not only of citizenship but all rights, fundamental rights and other rights. I quote the constitution, irrespective of caste, creed or sex. That is the constitutional definition. How can you violate this? But they are brazen, they'll do it. Why again? The question is targeting the minorities. Targeting the minorities, by this again intensify their polarization. And this drive, they have now started building detention camps in Bombay. They are building it in all the metropolitan centers. Why Chennai? I don't know whether they started here or the state government is allowing it or not. But, I mean, the possibilities are, except for Muslims and Christians, the rest of the people are ghar vapsi, people coming back here. So like this, they want to again divide and polarize. And this is going to really ruin the unity, integrity of our country. And already, the head of the Naga Liberation Army movement has said, we have never been under India, we will never be under India. Now these sort of tendencies will grow and that will create a further problem and that will give them a further handle to create a unitary state structure. These are the real dangers that are being posed today which we unitedly have to fight, otherwise we can't save India as we know of it today. And unless we save it, we can't change India for the better. And top it all, they have now brought in new laws whereby individuals can be declared as terrorists, they can keep you under detention and say you're a terrorist. They can come to any state, central government, without taking the permission of the state government. Pick up any individual, declare them as a terrorist, and attach their properties. And it is up to the individual who's been picked up to prove that he is not a terrorist. This is the inversion of the jurisprudence. You are supposed to be innocent till you are proven guilty. Now this government has said, you are guilty till you prove your innocence. And like this, every dissent against this government is to be targeted and persecuted. And top of all is that growing miseries of the people due to this economic recession. Why has this recession set in the country? Because people don't have money in their hands to buy. Because of that, industry is closing down. In the automobile sector, all of us know, now they have claimed that directly more than 2 lakh people have lost jobs. Indirectly, nearly 20 lakh people have lost jobs in the auto ancillary industries. 30 lakh jobs have been lost in the textile industry, your Tirupur being one of the major areas that has been hit. Like this, every sphere, things are just not being sold, they are being closed down. Our country in India, in Northeast, it's called the chai biscuit. I know in Tamil Nadu also it's tea and biscuits. You know, that's how the majority of the working people live. Now Britannia is saying the 5 rupee biscuit packet, the 5 rupee packet of biscuits, Britannia biscuits, that is not being sold today. So imagine what is the state of the life of the people of our country. They don't have money, growing unemployment, agrarian distress, factories shutting down, no future possibilities and no consumption, no money to buy. In this situation, the misery of the people is mounting and the answer to this is what? The answer to this is that the government should invest in big way in public investments, build our infrastructure, build our rural roads, build our irrigation channels, dig our wells for fresh water supply to our villages, build transportation avenues. Once they start building this and spending the money, then jobs will be created. Those who get the jobs will start spending their wages, and once they start spending, the economy will start reviving. So the point is public investment by the state to give people jobs and give them purchasing power. Instead, this government is doing exactly the opposite, which will make the situation much worse. And what is the government doing? They have given a package of 70,000 crores of rupees to your housing sector and to your export sector. People are not buying houses because they don't have money. Giving money to the people who are building houses doesn't help the houses being sold. Exports are not growing because world trade has fallen and falling, and exports cannot pick up. And your Tirupur is the classic example. Now giving money to people who are exporting, saying we'll give you concessions, export more. When world is not able to buy what you export, what is the point in giving money to them? And on top of that, now what have they done? 1,45,000 crores of concessions to your corporates, concessions to foreign investors, corporates, and concessions to foreign speculative capital. They have removed the capital gains tax on foreign funds coming into the stock market. That is why Sensex suddenly boomed 1900 points. And it fell after that, and it will fall further. But the point is, you are giving all the benefits, profit, more profits to the rich, and creating greater misery for the poor. This is the reality of this Modi government. Now this is something that we cannot accept, along with all the other things that are happening, what we were discussing. That's why in protest against this, the left parties have said in protest against these conditions, we will organize an All India protest agitation and movement. What is happening today is the consolidation of the political right in our country with the fascistic agenda of the Hindutva Rashtra. The answer to this right-wing offensive can only come from the political left, and it can only come from this red flag. And that red flag will mobilize the people in struggles and will advance and try to protect India from and the people from all these attacks. And therefore, from the 10th to the 16th of October, all over the country, all the left parties together have issued a call for all India protests, militant protest actions against all these policies on the basis of a minimum charter, demanding employment, demanding more purchasing power to the people and how that can be done, explaining that. On all these issues, this protest actions will be there. Therefore, I would only appeal to all of you in Tamil Nadu to come forward and join these protest actions, because Tamil Nadu has seen a rare unity. I'll end with that point later because it will be too long. But my appeal to you is to come forward and join and strengthen these protest movements in the period 10th to 16th October. Well, Tamil Nadu has shown a rare unity in the country in the recent past, when all secular democratic forces have come together. And I only hope that you'll carry forward this and strengthen this further to meet all these challenges and offensives that are being mounted today and join these protest movements in a big way. With that appeal to all of you and confidence that you'll come forward and strengthen these movements, I thank you very much for all the attention you've shown. Thank Comrade for the translation. And Thirumbi Ungalkellarkum Vanakkam.